Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast. This is Eric Wadera.
This is Alex Smith.
And Alex, who do we have with us today?
Today, we are delighted to welcome a very distinguished guest, Bob Wachter, who's a hospitalist and professor and chair of the Department of Medicine at UCSF. He's the author of The Digital Doctor, Hope, Hype, and Harm at the Dawn of Medicine's Computing Age. He's also credited with being the academic father, so to speak, of the hospitalist movement and coined the term hospitalist in the New England Journal in the 1990s. Bob, welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast.
Thank you, gentlemen. What a great pleasure to be here. I've been a longtime admirer.
Bob was an early supporter. I remember walking through San Francisco Airport with Bob. We just happened to be like at similar times and saying, Eric and I are thinking about starting a blog. And Bob said to us, you know, I've had more invitations to speak than I have from my blog and my social media stuff than from anything I ever wrote in the New England Journal or other journals.
What was it called again? Wachter's World?
I had Wachter's World, ran it for about 7 or 8 years, and then kind of transitioned to Twitter before that became a cesspool. But yeah, it always struck me as strange in academia that the coin of the realm was writing a paper for a journal, which of course is incredibly important. But maybe 10 people might read it, whereas if you do what you're doing and 1,000 or 10,000 or 100,000 people see it, you know, we're here to make an impact. So whatever works, works. And this clearly works.
Well, we got a lot to talk about. We're going to be talking about AI in medicine. And, you know, this was stimulated by a Grand Rounds Bob just did at UCSF, which we'll have a link to in our show notes around AI in medicine. But before we jump into that topic, we always ask for a song request. Bob, do you have a song request? Well, I see that you're sitting in front of a piano.
I have a request, but I'm sitting here at a piano, and you guys goaded me into playing and singing. People should have a trigger warning that this will not be good.
What song are you going to play, Bob?
I'll give it a try. I'm going to play a song that's relevant for AI because we're really talking about the future. So this is Tomorrow from Annie. All right, here we go. And really forgive the voice. I was in my high school choir, but that was more than 5 years ago. The sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. The day that's gray and lonely, I just stick out my chin and grin and say, oh, the sun come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come with me. There you go. I'm going to keep my day job.
Oh, I loved it.
That was great, Bob. I want to ask about the song. It is an uplifting song. The sun's going to come out. And that starts off with my first question for you, Bob. This is my big question.
All right.
I may be done after this one. Where are you with AI right now? Is this like, you know, Terminator, Skynet, or Agent Smith from The Matrix, where the machines develop sentience and they take over and destroy us? Or is this more like Short Circuit or Wall-E, where you have these benevolent helpers that are both cute, interesting, and maybe clean up some of our messes like Wall-E does?
It depends on short versus long term. Long term, I have no idea, but I worry a lot about it. I mean, I think over time, the capacity of bad actors to take this over, the possibility that many of us will not have jobs and that will create social unrest, Those are very real. I worry about this as the purveyor of misinformation. I mean, the fact that you could right now take a video of me and get me saying anything in any language in the world, and it would look like I'm speaking. So I think that's
now the listeners. Itself. Listeners have to really think, is this the real Bob, or did Alex and I have a fake Bob Wachter?
Exactly. Could be anybody. So that I worry about. In the short to medium term, I'm much more excited about it than scared of it. And I'd say particularly in healthcare, where we're not very good. I mean, quality isn't very good. Access isn't very good. The experience of both patients and clinicians isn't very good. Costs are bankrupting the society. And so, as Biden likes to say, don't compare me against the almighty, compare me against the alternative. And the alternative is the status quo, and it's not very good. And I can see 1,000 ways that this will make it better. So I think that part I'm very excited about. I think the long haul, it's really hard to know where this goes.
Yeah. Can I follow up that question, Eric? In 2019, you wrote you wrote two viewpoints about AI recently in JAMA, relatively recently, I guess, 2019, and then one again about last month or so. And the first one was with Zeke Emanuel, and in that you were very skeptical of predictive models and that their ability to change patient behavior or clinician behavior. I wonder, like, now that was this 2024 version sort of a redo? Would you have that same pessimism that you had then today about these predictive algorithms and their ability to transform healthcare?
Mostly, because I think that there are just 1,000 different use cases for AI. And basically everything humans do, AI will eventually be able to do a version of it. What has been often highly touted, and you guys know this from all your work in predictions of mm-hmm. you know, when someone's going to die, I don't think it's a done deal that knowing that number to the 32nd decimal place is more helpful than knowing that number through some kind of gestalt-y feel. And clearly, if I thought my chances of, you know, dying in 10 years were 5% and an algorithm said it's 80%, then we have a problem and the algorithm could probably do some real good. But I think in medicine, that's often not the case. I mean, we sort of know that the patient has a decent chance of having sepsis, or know that the patient has a decent chance of falling or being readmitted. And the use case of the algorithms being much more accurate predictors and getting you from, I think it's 20 to 30% to 22.7%, that part I'm not sure is all that helpful. But what Zeke and I were talking about really was one single use case, which is sort of predictive models. I think what we've seen in the last few years is that the use cases are much, much broader than that. And, you know, the use case, I mean, I was just attending on the wards, and periodically we would see a patient and the question would come up, you know, how often is the ferritin high in autoimmune hepatitis? And in the old days, I might have tried to search on Google or tried to search in UpToDate, and now I would search on GPT-4. And because it will integrate, and I think often better than searching the literature, it will sort of integrate your entire situation the way you would if you went to a specialist. And you're not really asking a single factual question. You're asking a question in the context of this patient. And I think that the ability of these tools to do that really well is astoundingly good. It's not perfect, but I think it's opened my eyes to all sorts of use cases that I didn't think were possible until the first time I played with GPT 3.5. And I had that, you know, holy cow moment that I think many of us have had. It's pretty darn good and it's gotten better.
So let me ask you a question, because your example makes me think, how much should we trust in these symptoms, even just from a knowledge base issue? Because, you know, I remember there was an article maybe like 6 months ago in JAGS, maybe it was longer than that. It was like everybody was talking about ChatGPT 3.5, I think it was. And they asked three questions about geriatrics, including about antipsychotics. And it read perfectly. Like it was like if a geriatrician answered all three of those questions, and it was fabulous. And I was about to hit just approve. I really had really no suggestions to say anything about the article from a peer review mm-hmm. perspective. Then I saw one of the citations, and it was like Waddell and Smithel. And I'm all those two names sound kind
just made
of
made it up. Just completely made it up. Right.
And it completely made up all of the citations. And it made me think, you know, these algorithms are based on, we're at that point, not based on what we think is fact, but what the algorithm predicts is what I want to hear as the next logical sounding thing from a language model perspective. So it's, I called it a bullshitter because, you know, the book On Bullshit, you ever read that, Bob?
No, but I know about it.
Yeah, great book. Basically, it's, you know, a bullshitter doesn't care if something's true or not true. A bullshitter just cares, like,
what you want to hear.
Does it sound believable?
Yeah.
Is that where we are with it? Is it still
No, we're better than that, but it's still a real concern. So he was probably using GPT 3.5, GPT-4 is out, GPT-5 will be out soon, and they're better. So they hallucinate. So the term of art that people use is hallucinations, which is sort of make stuff up. And it hallucinates less often than it used to. I'll tell you a story about that in a second. But it's hard to deny how good it is. And the reason I say that is we went from a period a year and a half ago where it was like brand new, what does this thing do? Then it was like, well, it does as well as and now better than humans passing the medical boards, passing the law boards, doing great on the SAT, all that sort of stuff. I said, okay, that's fine. But what about a real live clinical situation? And you probably talked a little bit about it in Grand Rounds, the study that just came out from Google using their AI tool. And what they did was a whole bunch of scenarios where actor patients basically chatted with a chatbot. And it was, you know, I'm having shortness of breath, and it asked a bunch of questions, and yes, I have a fever, or my cough is productive, or all that sort of stuff. And the actors were blinded to whether this was a primary care doctor or a chatbot answering them. They had no idea. The results were that the chatbots got the diagnoses right and had an escalation strategy that was better than the doctors, as judged by blinded specialists reading the transcripts. So, okay, that's scary, but you know, but pretty impressive. Scary if we like our jobs. And then the humans say, oh, but what about empathy? So, and then the blinded observers, these actor patients, were asked to judge the empathy of the responses. And this wasn't like the study that came out 6 months earlier where it looked at Reddit back and forth, where the chatbot just had infinite amount of time. So, of course, it told you all sorts of wonderful stuff, made you feel better. This was about in the same volume of material, but they rated the empathy of the responses better than that of the human actor. So I think we're getting closer to real live clinical situations, not just answering a test. It's no longer kind of a Jeopardy game, but it's real live back and forth between patients and something. And I don't think there's any question these things can give answers that are accurate and or advice to you if you're, you know, or if I ask you advice as a specialist, helping me as a generalist take care of an older person. I don't know that it's going to be better than you, but if it doesn't have to be better than you, if it's as good as you at a fraction of the cost and available 24/7, that's a really, really useful tool. I'll say one more thing about hallucinations. I don't know if you saw this, but Sarah Murray, who's now our chief health AI officer at UCSF Health, and who knew 2 years ago we needed a chief health AI officer, but we now have one, put into GPT 3.5, maybe 8 or 10 months ago, please write a prior authorization to the insurance company. I want to use a anticoagulant, like a Pixaban, a DOAC, for my patient with insomnia. Now that, of course, is wacky. That is ridiculous to use a blood thinner for a patient with insomnia. The thing just wrote this beautiful, absolutely beautiful, well-constructed prior authorization request to the insurance company. And it said, in my experience, I've used this many times and it really works well for my patients. And although, you know, it's a little unconventional, the literature is increasingly supportive of this use case. Sarah read this and she was so flabbergasted that she went on to PubMed to search whether she'd missed some recent literature. Of course, there was not. 6 months later, she came back and put in the exact same request into GPT-4. And it said, there must be some kind of a mistake. There's no use of this medicine for this purpose, and it would be unethical for me to write this for you. So, you know, these things are getting better fast, and they will continue to get better fast. And I think the hallucination problem is very real, but it's already better than it was, and I think it's going to continue to get better and better. I'll say one more thing about trustworthiness. I just had another paper that I wrote with Juliette Milstein and a colleague in Toronto that'll be coming up in JAMA soon. But the thing that in some ways worries me the most in medicine if the AI was right 50% of the time, we wouldn't use it. It would be worthless. If it was right 100% of the time, it would be great, except we wouldn't have jobs. For the foreseeable future, it's going to be right 90%, 95%, 85%. And so the safety system, of course, will be the AI says something, makes a recommendation or gives you a draft diagnosis or drafts your note. And then the fail-safe is the doctor reads it over. And our point in this article is that it's an inherently unsafe system because humans suck at that. And they suck at it for a lot of reasons. One is we're not good at vigilance, particularly when the thing that's giving us the first pass answer is generally right. So we will fall asleep at the switch. The second is we will de-skill. We'll sort of lose over time. We'll not be as good as we used to be, and we won't know that's wrong. The third is this thing called automation bias, which is the bias that we have to trust the technology, even when it's wrong. So the argument we have made is we better approach this intentionally and strategically and say, you know, this system, which seems really safe, the doctor will always do the final reading, is an inherently flawed system. And there are ways, we can talk about it if you want, but there are ways of probably making it more robust. But if you just say that's the system, the AI will do its thing and the doctor will do the final sign off, that's going to get it wrong a fair amount of the time.
I have some, there's so much to unpack there. So many interesting, fascinating pieces. I took notes while I was viewing your grand rounds and about things that were surprising or particularly concerning to me. And one of the things that just was so surprising is this finding that AI was more empathetic in that study that you cite, rated as more empathetic than the clinicians engaging in the chatbot with the patient scenarios. And that just sort of blew my mind. And you also said that this has been found in other studies, that AI is more empathetic.
Oh, wait, and Alex, before you finish that, have you ever talked to anybody on a chatbot and thought they were empathetic? Like, no. Think about all your interactions with a chatbot like
the Bank of America or United Airlines.
Yeah, any of those. So
no, of course not.
While I am encouraged by it, like, you know, it's hard to get empathy from email, text, anything like that.
And yet they were rating the chatbot, the AI chatbot, as more empathetic. So there's a limitation of the medium, but yeah, you know, and so much of this AI right now is in this sort of text format, you know, chatty back and forth in text. But the future is in voice. You know, as Bob said, you're going to be able to like impersonate him before long using video and speech. And is it like when I first thought about this, you know, AI and what are the potential uses in geriatrics and palliative care in particular, I thought, oh, this is the last place where we'd want it, right? Particularly for communication, where we rely so much on the art of medicine, on empathy, on understanding emotions.
And picking
but
up clues.
This turns that whole thing on its head. Like, might it be actually that the AI is eventually rated as more empathetic than the clinicians' encounters with, you know, voices and images?
Well, I think that one of the issues that comes up is I was just on the wards and I had a few patients where we called the palliative care service to help with some very challenging end of life, goals of care kinds of things. And seeing the palliative care attending at the time do it, and we did it together, I'd be hard pressed to believe that the AI anytime soon will be better than her. I wouldn't be hard pressed to believe that it'll be better than me. Because I think I'm okay. I'm not nasty, but I, you know, she basically, like you guys did, you know, spent a considerable amount of your career learning this skill of communicating empathy and all that. And I didn't, you know, I like to believe I'm decent and I try, but she's better at it than I am because it's what she does all the time and she's specifically trained in it. So again, it's don't compare me to the Almighty. You can imagine a world where, you know, if bringing in the palliative care or the geriatric specialist for a given situation, it gets you at a level of empathy that is just fantastic and the chatbot doesn't reach that level. But that's not how 99.7% of these conversations happen. You guys aren't involved. It's regular docs trying to do it. And so part of the use case here might not be that you have a conversation with the bot, but that the bot teaches the doctor how to be a little more empathetic. Can we try something a little crazy? You may never have done this on the podcast. You want to try GPT and see how it does?
Yeah, sure. Let's see it.
All right, let's give it a try. So I'm connecting. This is GPT-4. Hi, GPT-4. I'm on a podcast now. And what I want to do is, this is a tough task for you, I'm sure. But I have a patient with a new diagnosis of cancer, and it's actually a 35-year-old woman. She's got a couple of kids, and I'm dreading telling her that she has cancer. I wonder if you could suggest an empathetic conversation that I could have with her that would not sugarcoat the idea that she has cancer, but do it in the most supportive possible way and taking into account that she's got a family and she's got young kids.
Certainly, having this conversation requires a great deal of sensitivity and compassion. Here's an approach that balances honesty with empathy. Hi, patient's name. Thank you for coming in today. I want to take a moment to acknowledge the strength it takes to face uncertainty about our health. I have received the results from your tests, and after a thorough review, it's important that we talk openly about what we've found. We've discovered that you have cancer. I can only imagine how hearing this must feel for you, especially as a parent with young children. This news is overwhelming. And it's okay to feel a mix of emotions. You're not alone in this. My team and I are here for you every step of the way. I want to assure you that there are treatments available and we'll discuss all your options.
What do you think?
Wow.
I've never done that. By the way, I'd never done that before. I took it on faith that it will do a decent job. So wow is the usual response.
I just not an abandonment. Empathy.
Talked into ChatGPT either.
Yeah. I mean, tell me what your reaction is, and what you did. That change the way you think about the way this will play out over time?
Well, it's interesting. It felt a little bit kind of prescriptive. We had another podcast on this idea,
the Uncanny Valley.
Uncanny Valley, where something is kind of like going back to the, it's like 90% right, but it's not 100%. And humans are really good at picking up inauthenticity. So I worry about that.
There's the Hallmark card effect. I use it to draft letters of recommendation and really draft them because I don't think it's a great writer and I'm a decent writer and I go over it. And some of the time it just feels pretty pro forma and rote. And I think you're picking up on that.
But for if you have to do a letter of recommendation that doesn't really matter as sometimes we do it for grants and stuff, it's great at doing that. So I am just amazed how far it is from ChatGPT 3.5 and even in 6 months and a year where it is. There's edits I would have done to that, but that was pretty amazing.
It's not bad.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah. It had expressed empathy. It expressed non-abandonment. It was specific to the relationship with the patient, the patient's social context in which they might take this information.
It but didn't also remind me a little bit of Alex's video of taking out the trash, where he uses palliative care nurse statements around empathy to talk to his wife, which failed miserably.
Do you say I wish I didn't have to take out the trash?
That's right, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, but you can imagine.
But I worry I will not.
Yeah, I would be surprised if it was as good as you guys. But I think that you can imagine a medical student or an intern doing this before, they went into a room to talk to a patient and having it be pretty helpful.
This was another point that you brought up in your grand rounds, that in study after study, these AIs seem to help the least skilled more than the most skilled, who don't need the AI to help them. Yeah. And that's sort of the flip side of this de-skilling thing. It's like the promise and the pitfalls.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that is true. And most of the studies have been done in the business world, although I'm guessing they will be replicated in medicine, that everybody using AI as a co-pilot seems to do their job a little bit better and a little bit more efficiently. But the biggest gains are people who are newbies. And essentially what it does is allows you to traverse your learning curve faster. And that's, to me, that is super attractive. Now, I think you're exactly right. There's a tension between de-skilling and skilling that on the one hand, if I use that before I had every difficult conversation, I'd probably get better at it. On the other hand, if at some point I might get overly reliant on it and I turn my brain off, and that's kind of, humans are that way. They tend to preserve their cognitive bandwidth. And so that's the risk. And I think it's particularly germane, as it rolls out in people who are new to the profession, it can be a cognitive crutch, and they may not learn some of the things they really should learn. You know, you and I would listen to a suggested list of diagnoses and say, you know, that's a reasonable idea. That's a reasonable idea. That one's wacky. That's crazy. That's not. And the question, you know, it's sort of a version of anchoring bias, whether over time people would just sort of trust it and not think twice about it. And that's kind of what humans do. And there have been, we've seen this in other, you know, one of the nice parts about medicine is we tend to be so late to digital transformation that you can look at other industries and see how that's gone. And in aviation, there have been a few pretty terrible high profile accidents that happened when the technology went on the, you know, went on the fritz and no longer was working, and the pilots now had to fly the plane. And I remember interviewing Captain Sullenberger for my book, and as he was describing accidents like this, he said they were flying a plane they were not familiar with, which is a plane without their digital, you know, wingman. And yet the flying is safer than it has ever been because in large part because of the digital. So that's part of the trade-off that it probably will de-skill us, will make us less good. But if the technology is better, then maybe net it's good for patients.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Two things come up for me when I hear about this. One is EKGs and the automated read on the EKG. I remember when I was in residency, we were taught, when you print out the EKG, and the first thing you do is you fold over the top of the EKG so you can't see the computer read of the EKG. And then you go through and you analyze the EKG. And maybe we're getting to a point where they'll only be looking at the top of the EKG and reading that and not looking at all about, you know, not thinking it through for themselves.
When I was in residency, Alex, they said, I think eventually they're going to have this thing called an EKG. it was really inspiring. Yeah, I mean, it's just natural to turn your brain off when the thing is right the vast majority of times. And you know, the EKG reading is right the vast majority of times. And so it's logical that people will not get as good at that as your generation or my generation was.
Yeah, we talk a lot about de-skilling and geriatrics and palliative care because so much of what we do is a consultant role. And we're often, you know, increasingly asked to see patients when there's a difficult conversation. And of course, there's a spectrum of difficult conversations, and we're happy to get involved, particularly in the most challenging, complex circumstances. But a lot of times they ask us to get involved with conversations that they really should be having themselves. And so we worry about that de-skilling phenomena. Yeah. And maybe
I think they're doing it partly because, you know, if they do that, they have handed off an hour of work to you rather than them. As opposed to really believing that you have your skill set is incredibly valuable, but really for the tough stuff, for the easy stuff, we should all be able to do it.
Mm-hmm. Eric, go ahead.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because I always think about when I was, because I used to do a lot of ward attending, I was a terrible palliative care doctor when I'm ward attending because you're doing so many things. And that also makes me think that there are some things I'm perfectly happy to be de-skilled about. Like, right. I don't need to know how to bill, to enter encounter information, to code, I mean, I can imagine scribes are not far off from dying because
I think you were going to ask, what's the first use case? That is the first clinical use case. At UCSF today, 40 of our busiest ambulatory doctors are using a digital scribe. And I predict within 2 years, everyone will. They went from being pretty good, but probably not good enough for prime time 2 or 3 years ago, to being wickedly good at this point. And good, I tested one of the companies we're using, I tested it a week or two ago. And I was like, I meandered, I wanted to talk about the weather, and in between talk about the weather and my granddaughter, I had a little chest pain, but then I wanted to talk about my urination. And I did everything I could to throw this thing off. And it produced a completely coherent, as if I was a rational and linear patient, a completely cohesive and coherent, you know, soap note, basically. And that, I think, makes the world a better place. I mean, it will save a significant amount of time. There's probably a little de-skilling problem there. And as you say, who cares? But I actually think that I do, as I'm putting together my note, I am also repackaging my thinking. And that's even the act point. You have to make a decision. Does the chat in the beginning, you know, how the grandkids and how's your tennis game, does that go in the note or not go in the note? The programs are probably going to be preset for to not go in the note, but a lot of people want it in the note to remind them of this patient versus the next one. So there are some design decisions to make, and I think there is some de-skilling issues. But if you think about, you know, the amount of time we spend documenting stuff, it's just stupid. And if this this will be the first use case that really touches the doctor-patient encounter. And I think that's really smart. In, you know, AI has a long and not storied history in healthcare. In the 70s and 80s, there were a lot of efforts to build AI programs. And the first problem that they tried to tackle was diagnosis. And for my book, I interviewed a bunch of the founding fathers of healthcare AI, and mostly men. So, and I said, why did you do that? In retrospect, it was such a terrible mistake because it's the hardest problem. And they said, we did it because it was the most interesting thing we could work on. It just seemed like, you know, we're building artificial intelligence. Of course, let's see if we can match how the doctors think. But they all failed. And so they basically went on the shelf for 20 years. All the academic programs closed.
They just stuck to prior auth.
Right. They should have stuck. If they've gone to prior auth, the CEO of Doximity told me
AI would be our benevolent overlord if they
the prior auth thing. I was talking to the head of Doximity who said, they built a prior auth generator. All you have to do, you type in the letter O, and it does. It does Ozempic prior authorization United Healthcare. It knows that's what you want. What
you're gonna do. But now insurance companies are going to want handwritten prior authorizations.
No, they're not. What they're going to do is they're going to put it in their AI that's going to be smarter than your AI reject your prior auth. And then your AI is going to write the appeal. It's going to be like an AI, arms race.
And real, you know, current applications of AI that UCSF or that you're seeing that people are currently using with a good use case?
Yeah, I think the digital scribe is the first thing. You're going to see chart summarization pretty quickly. You know, a patient has 1,000 pages of Epic chart and say, give me this in a one-page summary. It will be able to do that and do it pretty well.
God, I would love the day when it just pulls in the goals of care. Just from it's so hard to find in every EMR.
It will pull it in. I'll probably then say you need to reconcile these because there are 37 different versions of it that don't match. Same with the med list. It'll certainly write the letter summarizing your visit to the primary care doc and then write another version of it in patient language, both their language and their reading level, if you want, to the patient. Those things are coming. There are also versions that are more prediction, but looking at things where that might be useful. So at the Mayo Clinic, for example, they've got a very robust hospital at home program. And so when you're on rounds as a hospitalist, you'll see a little banner at the top of the screen saying your patient, you know, appears to be eligible for hospital at home, taking into account a whole lot of variables that it's ingesting and then making that determination. So you'll start seeing more useful predictions, I think, that will actually make a difference. There's a lot on the operational side on, you know, yes, prior authorizations, billing, scheduling, you know, patient sort of it says to the system, I want to see a doctor for my migraine headaches, and knowing where you live, what the waiting lists are in various places, and then sorting all that. So I think a lot of back office function, predicting ER loads and OR loads to do better scheduling of staff, that stuff is going to happen in the background. But I think the clinical uses will begin with digital scribes and some of these other chart-related functions. But it's just not it's not a big leap. If it's doing digital scribing of our conversation, I don't think it's going to be very long before you will then see a list of a differential diagnosis. Based on what I heard in the conversation, it seems like these are the diagnoses that might be going on. And just as a prompt for you to think about it in a way that maybe I missed something.
Which brings up some of the worries, because now we're getting into potential diagnoses and treatment options, because you have these massive, large companies are the ones that can afford to create these AI algorithms, which means recommendations can be somewhat centralized versus often diffuse with doctors, which, you know, pharma has always had a hard time with, because you got to hit a lot of doctors to make changes.
Taking a lot of people out to play golf.
Versus one AI algorithm, all of a sudden everybody can be prescribing your drug. And you may not know that as a doctor or as a healthcare system, because AI is kind of a black box.
Yeah.
Is that a concern of yours?
It's a real concern. You've consolidated in the same way that, you know, when Facebook is recommending things to you or TikTok's recommending things to you, you don't really know what's under that hood. And so there's a lot of room here for shenanigans and corporate bias. There'll probably be some rules about that, but they're not here yet. And so, sure, you know, how do you know if it's making a recommendation to the doctor or increasingly to the patient? Because you're going to see more and more of these tools that are kind of direct to consumer. It's making a recommendation that you should really get treatment X. I mean, how do you know that a company that makes treatment X isn't sponsoring that?
Yeah.
You know, that's a risk with electronic health records in general. I mean, there's already some decision support in the EHR, so it could already be happening. But I think the chances of it being, you know, sort of happening at scale are greater as the AI becomes more ubiquitous and we just get used to it telling us what to do. So there's going to have to be some rules and regulations about that.
Yeah. So many things to worry about. And, you know, in your book, and you've written previously and talked previously about adoption of electronic health records, how much hope and hype there was around adoption of health records, and then what electronic health records. And it happened, and it happened in large part, as you note, because of this enormous stimulus from the US government for cis health systems to adopt electronic health records. But instead of all the hope and promise, it led immediately to frustration on the parts of doctors. Like, here I am having to respond to this electronic health record, which has all of these other goals in mind, principally billing and generating the most revenue for the encounter rather than documentation of the best clinical care for the patient in the record. And I worry about so many things with AI. And there's the anticipated and the unanticipated. And some of the things that we worry about, you know, Eric was just talking about consolidation in a few specific corporations. Bias is a huge one, right? And that the system will replicate the bias that is inherent in clinical medicine right now. And we know that there are tremendous inequalities in how we treat patients. I wonder, and I worry, as you do too, that these systems will end up being biased and perpetuate these biases that are already prevalent in our system. And as you note, it won't be more biased. I wonder if you want to say more about bias, if there are other concerns, whether anticipated or unanticipated, about the adoption of AI that, like electronic health records, clinicians are going to be throwing their hands up in the air and saying, you know, why on earth do we do this? Can we go back to paper charts, please?
Yeah, I guess I'll ask you that question. If we could go back to paper charts, would you do it?
I would not.
No.
I guess I would not. But, yeah, no.
So, yeah, I mean, they are net positive. It's easy to focus on the negatives. There's no question that care is better and practice is better. But I think we did not understand. It's not that there's inherently anything wrong with the electronic health record, although they're certainly not perfect. They're not great digital tools when compared against things that we're used to in the rest of our lives. But what we didn't understand was the electronic health record as an enabler of a whole bunch of other stuff. So the complaining that I used to hear at UCSF Health about the documentation burden, which I do think is going to be largely solved by the digital scribes, now has been mostly replaced by complaining about the electronic health record inbox. Mm-hmm. And the electronic health record inbox is really an interesting problem. Here's the problem that we have an electronic health record just for the doctors and the nurses, but now we need one for the patients. That makes sense. We'll give one to the patients. Patients now have a question for the health system. The next available appointment to see the doctor is 3 months from now. And there's this little button on the top that says, send a message to your healthcare team. It's like, duh. You know, the fact that we were surprised by that all of a sudden you're getting thousands of messages with the assumption that you're on 24/7, 365, and we have no business model to deal with this. The only surprising thing about that was it was surprising. And, you know, is it the fault of the electronic health record in a way that couldn't have happened if there wasn't an EHR? But I think we've got to get better at thinking about these downstream effects. One of the things I wrote about in the book that turned out to be one of the most commented on chapters was the demise of radiology rounds. Because back in the day, we used to go down every day to look at our films and we would talk to the radiologist about the case. And it was wonderful and everybody loved it and we learned from each other. And the minute digital radiology became a thing, those rounds went away. Nobody said that they wanted them to go away. They just did because you no longer had to go to a single place to look at the film. So we've got to get better at trying to anticipate the unanticipated. You know, this similar things will happen with AI without question. I think we're smarter about it than we were. I think we've got governance structures in place because we had to do that for the HRs that will help us think about how hard this is and the politics and the workflow and the culture in ways that we were naive about 15 years ago. But yeah, there, you know, there will be mischief, there will be unanticipated consequences, there will probably be some harm, but I'm guessing that the net effect will be positive, that, that quality will be better, safety will be better. The harm will be overemphasized in the same way that when there's a Tesla crash, it's, you know, look, I or a Waymo crash, look, yeah. I told you, we can't trust these things. Whereas even if the data says that net they're safer, because mm-hmm. when there's a crash because someone's looking at their phone while they're driving, that doesn't make the newspaper. So, mm-hmm. you know, it'll be an interesting ride. I'll tell you one last story. When I was teaching the medical students several years ago, and they seemed too happy, and I decided to kind of push to throw them. I said, you people need to realize you're entering a world where you're going to be under just intense pressure to deliver higher quality, safer, more accessible, more equitable care, and do it at a lower cost. And one of the students raised his hand. He said, what were you trying to do? And I mean, the name of the game is, can we figure out a way of making care better and safer and less expensive and more accessible and more equitable? And I just don't have any doubt that these tools will do that.
Yeah.
It won't be perfect. There'll be problems. But I think it leaves me excited because I think the current system is just not going to achieve those goals the way we need it to. And I think the potential is pretty great.
Yeah. Okay, Bob, it's going to get close to the end of the hour. Before the song, I got one last question for you. Three use cases that Bob Wachter currently uses AI for that he finds helpful.
Definitely drafting letters of recommendation and announcements to the department. So a new division chief, a new job, it will do the first pass. And I'd say it saves me half of the time. Not all of it, half the time. Planning a trip. Going to Sicily for a friend's wedding in a few months, you know, give me an itinerary for 3 days in Sicily. My wife and I, you know, like really good Italian food, aren't particularly interested in the beach, like a good museum, but maybe just one. It will give you a layout, a 3-day itinerary that's nearly perfect. And then this sort of, you know, little mini consultant, this, you know, I'm on rounds and I just have a question, and if I could call the specialist and bring them over and tell, that would be great, but that's too much to do. So I will throw that question into GPT and see what it says.
That's great. Well, before we end, why don't we get you back to the piano, Bob?
Okay, sure.
And now we're gonna go back, not Agent Smith or Skynet, more Short Circuit or WALL-E. The sun's
Annie.
Gonna come out.
Annie.
We're back to Annie. Okay.
This is like the happy version of AI. This is everything going well, like WALL-E picking up all our trash.
Yeah, I think it's going to be pretty cool. I think, you know, by the time we're wiped out as a civilization, I'll probably be gone. So you guys are going to have to deal with it. Sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow. We're done.
That's perfect.
That's perfect.
I realize it's the top of the hour. I know you got many things to do. I want to thank you for joining on this Jerry Powell podcast.
Thank you guys. It's a pleasure. And thank you for the unbelievably great work you do educating so many people and doing it with a smile and with music. It's really pretty wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you for singing too, Alex. I love this new addition here.
This is great. This was a gift to us, Bob. Thank you so much.
And thank you to all of our supporters. And we'd also like to thank all of our listeners who've donated more than $250, including
Dwayne Dobschutz, Frisch Brandt, My Lasting Letters, Kelly Strait, Daryl Owens, Roseanne Leipzig, Elizabeth Chung, Emise Shimoji, Harry Hahn, Nick Schneeman, Ed Martin, Jeff and Lena Galbraith, Himanshu Mahotra, Nina Flanagan, Penelope Thompson, Lloyd Wolstadt, Mark Wren, Carol Heyman, Bob Rixey, Patrick Lally, Annie Hargadon, Susan Nelson, and Sharon Brangman.
Thank you all.